All right, Matthew chapter 10. It's good to have Madeline here and Eric and Tona as well. As you know, Madeline lost her husband on Monday. Still need to be praying for her and the family. They would have been married 70 years in May. 70 years in May. And certainly is good to have her here. Matthew chapter 10. And the first two verses there of Matthew chapter 10. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these. The first, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, and James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother. Then it continues naming all of them in that group. But we're going to stop right there for the reading this morning. Father in heaven, Lord, I love you. Lord, I ask your blessing upon the service today. Lord, I pray that you'd fill me with your spirit. I pray you would control, Lord, what I say and how I say it. I pray that you would meet the needs that are here in this room. Father, I pray, Lord, if there's anyone here who does not know Christ as Savior, Lord, I certainly pray that the knowledge of that and your conviction upon them, that even today they would repent and put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray for those who need comfort. I certainly pray for that need to be met today. Lord, for those who need encouragement, for those who need rebuking, Lord, I just pray your spirit and your word would have free course in the service today to change us. Again, Lord, I love you. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Now, I spent 9 years in the Air Force, 1989 to 1998. And in order, of course, to get into the Air Force, you got to enlist. Now, not everyone who enlists really makes it into the Air Force. Some are going to be weeded out fairly quickly, whether that's basic training and things like that. But once you enlist, you know, you do head out. You head into basic training. After you finish basic training, you know, then it was on to tech school at that time and learning, getting more specifics about the particular job that I'm going to be doing and getting the training for that. And I did that at Chinook Air Force Base. And then after I graduated from tech school, I was sent to my first real assignment now, was given. That was Holloman Air Force Base in New Mexico. However, when I got there, I still was not out of the training phase. I still had some training to do. I was what they would call a three-level, if they still do that in the Air Force nowadays. And I still had to go through a lot more training before I could be trusted on my own to do the given tasks that are there. Once a certain amount of qualifications and training was completed, I would be upgraded to what they called a five level. And then at that time, all right, much more freedom now to do the job. They're telling me, all right, the training is in place and you're ready. You know, your supervisor sees that and he can even advance from there to a seven level and things like that. Well, much of that pattern is what we see taking place in the lives of the disciples. There's a lot of similarities here, and you know, in their service to the Lord. And you know, first thing they had to do was put their faith in Christ. They had to enlist. They had to have that conversion take place. And then they had a time of training, some basic training, some tech school, and even sort of on-the-job training, even when Christ begins to send them out. And again, in our text, the disciples are getting their very first assignment or mission. They still wouldn't be at that five level yet. They're sort of at that three level status right now. But last week, remember, as we looked last week at Jesus' ministry among the people, we saw how he was traveling from village to village, working tirelessly for the needs of others, preaching, teaching, healing. And then he told the disciples how he viewed the multitudes, how he saw them as faint, as scattered, as sheep having no shepherd. He was moved with compassion. He says, we need to pray the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his field. And now, of course, he is getting ready to do just that. He's going to be sending forth laborers into the field. And for the first time, he is going to be sending 12. He's going to put them in groups of two and sending them out. And so, from the multitudes that have been following him, when we come to chapter 10, he selects 12 men to become apostles. Now notice the title changes. If you'll look in verse 1, he refers to them as 12 disciples. When you come to verse 2, it's the very first time it's mentioned. It's now apostles. It's now apostles. All right, so change is taking place now. They're no longer just disciples. They now have advanced to being called an apostle at this time. There was something about these 12 men that caused the Lord to select them. And we're going to start to look at that today and probably into next week as well. Matter of fact, we're not going to quite get into the different men. I'm going to talk about them today in general, about all 12 of these men, about what we see about them. And again, chapter 10 is a great chapter. It really can have a profound effect on your life. It's a chapter that introduces a transition time in the ministry of Christ. There's some great truth here. There's some great teaching here. It even has some parts that are taken well out of context, and we'll deal with that when we get to it. but anyhow, I really think it can be a help in your life. But we're going to start by looking at who Christ selects and learning from them. And again, I hope what I want you to see today is this. I want you to see how Christ can overcome difficulties in your life. How you think, well, nope, there's just stuff in my life that, you know, this just isn't changing and I don't think God's going to use me. You would be wrong about that. All right, you would be wrong about that. And I want you to see that. And I hope you'll see the kind of men the Lord was looking for, the kind of person that the Lord is looking for. And I hope you'll be stirred to a greater desire to love him and to serve him. The fact is, we need to move on in our Christian life from being disciples to apostles. Now, not the 12. Please, we're not going to go around with badges and I'm an apostle so-and-so. The actual office of the apostle of these 12, there was actually 14 altogether, when Matthias and then Paul. But this office is finished. It's over with. Doesn't matter what group you go to, and one claims to be an apostle, he's not an apostle. He does not meet, nobody alive could possibly meet the biblical requirements to be one of the apostles. It's not possible. There's several requirements for it. One of them was in 1 Corinthians 9, you had to see the resurrected Christ. All right, you had to have time with him and fellowship with him, and that's not true. Paul had that out of season. Paul had that where Christ personally did come to him, I believe also in Arabia as well. So he met that requirement. Nobody else does. There's other ones as well, chosen of the Lord. There's several down there that we can get into. But that's not the purpose of this message. So I'm not using the word apostle in that sense. I'm using it by just simply the meaning of the basic word apostle. It means a sent one. In Christ's day, it was a naval term. It would be used when the Navy was being sent out on a mission to a foreign nation. They would be looked at as apostles being sent forth to represent one nation before another nation. It was also used of any of the king's men that would be sent forth with a message from the king. It'd be used in that sense as well. And Christ is now using it in sense of those representing the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So there's growth here that is taking place in the lives of these men, so much so that Christ is now transitioning them. Now they're just not following him and watching. He's saying, now we're changing this up. You've been watching me this whole time. Now I'm sending you. So we're going to take a look at that, about what is taking place here, about these men that he selected. The 12 men he selects here, none of them were wealthy. And I certainly think that was important. They're not going to persuade men to follow them because of financial power. None of them were men of rank or noble. So they weren't going to be able to compel men to follow Christ. These were average men. These were average men that really had no education or ability of their own for the task. Yet after 3 years of being with Christ, they would set off to change the world. We will see things here that will help us to make a difference in the kingdom of God and to make a difference starting right where we're at in Anchorage, Alaska. So today, I'm going to look at two things. I'm going to look first, the first part of this is the challenges that Christ faced with these men. These men were far from perfect, and then we're going to get into what it took for these men to be sent. What were some things in it that Christ was looking for? What was in place in their life that Christ said, you know what, I'm selecting these 12. So first off, let's look at some of these challenges that were in the lives of these 12 men that needed to be overcome. And today we're going to look at this in a general sense, and then next week we'll get a little bit more specific with the different men and different of the 12 men that are involved here. But anyhow, none of these fellows were perfect. They were very far from it. And yet we see a change that is produced in each of their lives. they change. It wasn't like they were stuck in the rut of the current personality or character traits that they had. They changed. They grew. It really is amazing to see what type of men these fellas become. And again, when we look at these men and we see how the Lord changed them, we can realize, man, there's hope for me. I mean, we can really get down on ourselves to the point saying, really, there's just no hope for me. I just can't get help with this. You would be wrong on that. You would be wrong. I think back in my own life at the different times where that hindered me. I never thought I could ever speak in front of people after the first time I tried it. I never wanted to do that again. It was just a horrible experience. It wasn't me. That wasn't who I was. And yet the Lord was going to call me to preach. That went directly against who I was. I knew my own shortcomings. I knew the different things that I battled. I certainly could never see myself as being a missionary on an island in the middle of the Pacific Ocean living in the jungle. That's not me. It certainly was not. And I can think of different times in my life, even since I have been here, saying, Lord, are you sure you've got this right? Are you sure you got this right? And again, you might be thinking there's something in your life that you can't overcome or that you've struggled overcoming. You think it's just a part of you. But the Lord certainly can change you and conform you to the image of his dear son. Listen, one of the tricks that your flesh will play on you, that the devil will play on you, is you get in this thing, you think you can't win this thing. You would be wrong. You would be wrong. Now, as we get into these men, here's some things that Christ had to deal with the 12 men that he selected. These were men that lacked understanding. They lacked understanding. All right, it wasn't like he was picking from the most highly educated. I mean, think about some of the parables that Christ was talking about, or he was talking about eschatology, future things that were coming up, or Christ talking about his suffering that he would go through. You know, you can think of the different parables, or again, talking about what was going to happen. I could just see Peter looking at John. Did you get that? Remember when Christ was talking about beware of the leaven of the Pharisees? You know, and you got Peter looking at Andrew. Did we forget bread? Did we forget bread? And Christ is like, oh my goodness, I'm not talking about bread. They lacked understanding. They lacked understanding. I can think of the times where I have felt completely clueless. Clueless. I remember when I first started serving God, just getting into church and serving him, when I could not have told you again where the Gospel of John was. I remember sitting in church time and time again feeling intimidated just when the pastor would say, open your Bibles and turn to. I didn't know where anything was. I had Genesis down. I had that down. If he said Genesis, I was good to go. I would literally, so I wouldn't, and it never really worked that well for me, I would keep my finger where the table of contents was, where the list of the books of the Bible were. And so, but my problem was I still didn't know the order of that, and there's 66 books in here. And so I'm sitting around people, and they would say, he would say, turn to, and they would just be flipping to it. I'm like, I have no idea where we're going. And then, so I get to the table of contents, I don't want them to know that I have to go to the table of contents to find where this book is. So my Bible's half open, and then I got to find the book. And if you look, you know, it's just listed. I'm like, oh, where's the book? Where's the book? Where's the book? And just feel intimidated. Didn't even know where to turn. By the time I found it, he's on point two of his message. So there's certainly times even when I look at the disciples and I see how what understanding and wisdom they lacked, and I realize there certainly is hope for me. And again, it really is amazing who the Lord chooses. And as we learn, as we look at the lives of the apostles, the Lord begins to illuminate truth to them as you begin to walk with him. He gives the understanding that is needed. These men in the book of Acts end up speaking before the doctors of the law. And they know, wait, these are unlearned and ignorant men. And yet they're speaking with amazing wisdom. And, of course, they took knowledge that they had been with Jesus Christ. So, and that'll tie in a little bit later in the message here. So, again, Christ, when he selected these men, he was dealing with men that lacked understanding. Number two, these men certainly had sin to be dealt with, sins like pride. No, they would have discussions while they're traveling down the road of who is the greatest. among them. You know, they're traveling literally with the Son of God. They're traveling down the road, and they don't even recognize it as sin. They don't even see it as sin. They're walking down. I mean, Christ is right there. So who do you think is going to be the greatest? Who do you think is going to be the greatest? I mean, this is who Christ is dealing with. This is, and remember, he is going to use these men to change the world. But there's a whole lot of molding that has to take place in their life. You know, we see this today, the same thing. You know, go to our preacher's conference and you'll begin to see it worded in different ways. It won't be who's the greatest among us. It's what did you run on Sunday? What did you have on Sunday? How many people in your church on Sunday? It's a different wording for who thinks the greatest among us. Same thing. But the Lord began to change them and work in their life. He took the men who lacked understanding. He began to provide understanding. He dealt with men that were struggling with sin, sin they were even ignorant of. And he began to work on their heart. And you're going to see in the future that these men demonstrate at times amazing humility. They had sin that needed to be dealt with, and Christ certainly was going to do that. Again, as we walk with him, not only does he illuminate truth, he begins to clean us up. These men were also fearful. At times, they demonstrated great fear. And as you know, in the ministry, it requires boldness. They all forsook Christ the night he was betrayed, confused at the event, still lacking understanding of all that was taking place. When Christ is arrested, they all scatter. And then we have the more specific, detailed account about Peter. How Peter was trying to stay close and trying to maintain a closeness to the Lord. I mean, they're just, he can look at him. He is that close. And I certainly give Peter a lot of credit for that. As far as we know, he's the only guy that's right there. But even Peter, when he was faced with the reality of whether to acknowledge that he is one of his disciples and followers, he chooses to deny Christ. When a woman who spots him and says, listen, you're one of them, you've been with him. All of a sudden, out of the blue, he says, I don't know. Not me. He never thought those words would ever leave his mouth. Remember, just hours before he made the great profession, Lord, I'm ready to die for you. I'm ready to go to prison for you. And the Lord knew. The Lord knew when he said that, that wasn't true. That wasn't true. Fear would grip him, and he would deny the Lord. We see it again when Peter was walking on the water, and fear overtook him, and he fell. Yet you see, all of these men will end up giving their life for the Lord. They're all going to be martyred, with the exception of John, who they tried to martyr. They're all going to be martyred. So you see, a change takes place. You're going to see men that at one point in time, when Christ was speaking certain of the parables or talking about things that were up and coming, they were completely clueless. At one point, Christ is so frustrated with them. I think when he was talking about the issue with the leaven, he said, oh, ye of no faith. And yet we see them change. We see them with boldness. We see them with wisdom. And another thing Christ had to deal with them, which I just brought up, was the fact was they did have little faith. Remember when Christ was on the boat? I've already preached on this. And he's sleeping in the boat and the storm hits. And all the disciples think that they're going to perish. They're forgetting that the Son of God, the creator of the universe, is right there in the boat with them. And they run down. They wake him up. We're going to perish. Christ rebukes them for their little faith. And yet these are the men that Christ is going to use to change the world. I know many times, I can think of my own life, I'm sure you can too, where you look at how little your faith actually is. But this was what Christ was dealing with these men. And of course, I can think all the times my lack of faith has disappointed me greatly, and yet God still chose to send me to P&G. He knew there's going to be a growing time. And perhaps you think your faith hinders you. Well, join the club. Join the club. The apostles struggled with faith, yet the Lord worked in their life and their faith grew. Now, let's look at the process from disciple to apostle. The process here from disciple to apostle. First, as I mentioned earlier, there has to be a genuine conversion to Jesus Christ. A genuine conversion to Jesus Christ. As we know, even of these 12, one of these is a false convert. And that is Judas Iscariot. He's not genuine. He's not true. The Lord even brings it up before he denies him. The Lord says in John 17 that there is one among us, you know, who was not a genuine convert, and that is Judas Iscariot. But there absolutely has to be a time in your life when a genuine conversion to Jesus Christ takes place. We see the first of all these converts is Andrew, who then goes and finds Peter. And we see it begin to take place in your life. where they realize who Christ is and they convert unto him. They realize that it's not through baptism, it's not through your church, it's not through church membership, it's not through communion. Genuine conversion comes as a result when you see yourself as the sinner that you are before a holy and a righteous God who is absolutely going to judge you. You will be found guilty. He's not going to weigh your good works and your bad works. I mean, you're such a good church member. No, he's going to see you as wretched and putrid before him. He's not going to compare you with others in your neighborhood. The standard was Jesus Christ himself. You're going to stand before that holy God lost, undone, guilty. And we know from Scripture that all those who are found guilty at judgment are cast into a lake of fire. Every single one. See, I don't believe that. Listen, don't believe in gravity either and go jump off a mountain. See how much that's going to help you. This book is the Word of God. There's no other book like it, period, in the universe. It is incredible. And it speaks clearly of it. So something needs to take place where it looks like you have never sinned, where it looks like you are perfect in order for conversion to take place. Well, that's what Jesus Christ did. He came, this was God in the flesh, lived a perfect life on this earth. Perfect. And he did that in your place. He did that, so remember, he went to the cross. Many people know that Christ died on the cross, but again, they really don't understand what that was all about. He was literally taking your place in judgment. He was dying for you. It was as if he was the one who committed all those sins and broke God's law. There's a verse that talks about it in 2 Corinthians 5:21. It says, "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." When he was on the cross, that verse teaches us what was taking place. He was literally becoming sin for you. It was as if, again, he literally took your place in judgment. And the Father was judging him for your sin. And he died in your place. But hell did not hold him. Because he wasn't just a man. This was God. And after 3 days and three nights, he rose again from the dead. And at the same time he did that and taking your place, what that verse says, he gives you his righteousness. Did he have sin? Absolutely not. That's how you can look perfect or justified before God. And it is the only way. It is when you realize what Christ did for you and you realize that you need him and you repent and put your faith in him. You don't mix this with anything else. You don't mix it with your church and with baptism, with communion. A lot of those things are great things, but they're not the road to heaven. The church of Galatians already in the first century got off on that, and Paul let them know that they had left the gospel. They were mixing it in. It wasn't that they were now denying the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They were adding to it. But that's so common today. But it is only when you come to Christ, just like that thief on the cross did, huh? When he realized of his own wretched condition, he realized he's getting ready to die and be judged. He didn't ask to come down from the cross. The first one did, and Christ said nothing to him. The second one who Christ saved, he never asked to come down from the cross. What he was afraid of was the judgment to come. He said, "Lord, when thou comest into thy kingdom, remember me." The Lord turns to him and says, "Today thou shalt be with me in paradise." Well, what did he do? Exactly what every man has done who God has ever saved. And that is he recognizes his own wretched condition and how the only one could help him is the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he put his faith in him. That is genuine conversion. So all of those men here, with the exception of Judas, had a genuine conversion in their life. Now, secondly, and this is the important one here, after conversion, is they were learning from Christ. You will never be sent as an apostle without spending time learning. Basically going to school, if you will. Now, the key to learning here is not a classroom setting. It is not. The key to learning here is not a classroom setting. Oh, certainly that is a small part of it, the teaching that is needed. I'm not saying that, but the key here that we see was spending time with Christ. He grabbed these men. These men, Peter, you know, Peter and Andrew had their fishing business. They left that. They were going to spend this time with the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I was in PNG for 12 years. It took me more than 10 years before I figured this out. I really wish I'd have known this year one. It took me 10 years. And that was when I was trying to get men ready there. And, you know, many of them had trouble reading, so we had to start teaching them reading and trying to get them growth. And year in and year out, trying to get men ready to pastor. It was frustrating. It was a long process. At times, you lack to see the growth. But I was doing it in basically an American-style way. We had the Bible college hours set up. They were coming to the Bible college hours. I'm doing the teaching. At times, it'd be frustrating. I'd see it go through, you know, one ear and just out the other. Man, this just isn't registering. And I'm taking me just years. What would take, you know, 2 to 3 years here was, I mean, 6 years going by, 7 years going by, 8 years going by. I'm not seeing anybody ready. And then I was forced into a situation, realized I'm going to be coming back here to pastor now. I've got one guy about ready for the work in Sohon. Been working with him since I've been there, all those years. And he still wasn't ready yet. And I realized, man, I got working kudu kudu. So I took that guy, and I had him with me 6 days a week, morning till night. You're just going to be with me 6 days a week, morning till night. This is how we're going to do this. And so I had him move close to where my house was. He had an uncle that didn't live far away. Move in with your uncle. You're going to be with me morning till night. I got more accomplished in 12 months than I did with him than I did with 8 years with the other man. And then it clicked about a quarter of the way through that when I realized this is starting to work. Why did I not follow the biblical pattern to begin with? Why didn't I follow that to begin with? And the reality was I probably still needed about another 2 years with that fella, not just that 1 year. But nonetheless, they learned from Christ because they spent time with Christ. They were with him. They saw how he lived. They saw what he did. And again, the Bible says in Mark 3:14 that these 12 were ordained that they should be with him. That was the key to their learning process. It was being with Christ. I want to give a quote here. This was a quote I found from a pastor. He was talking about the times that the disciples had spent with Christ. I just want to read what he said. He said, "Can you imagine walking every day with Jesus? Can you imagine hearing his matchless wisdom? Everything he ever said was perfectly wise and absolutely true. Can you imagine being with someone who never lost his temper, never got angry, but was only righteously indignant over things that took glory from God? Can you imagine being with someone who cared absolutely nothing for himself, but always gave himself to everybody else? Being with someone who was totally consumed with literally wearing himself out with fatigue to do the will and the work of another person? Can you imagine being with someone who could love anybody and everybody? Someone who could raise the dead, heal the sick, give sight to the blind, and hearing to the deaf? How amazing would that have been?" Well, that's who they were with. They were seeing this take place every day, and that's what was changing them. And you say, yes, but we don't have Christ here on earth. This is true, but we have the Holy Spirit of God. He has put things in place so the growth can still take place. We have the Holy Spirit of God indwelling us. At this point, the apostles did not have that. We also have the local church. We also have the local church, the institution he gave for the perfecting of the saints. These things are in place, not just to sit here to come and be entertained, but so that we can actually grow in our life to go from not only being converted, but to being a disciple, and then from being a disciple to being an apostle, being one who is sent forth that's actually in the work of God. Not as a pastor. That doesn't mean necessarily you leave your job. It means that you change your view of your job and you see yourself as the ambassador that you are. These men, they spent this time with Christ, and yet we have the Holy Spirit of God. I think we also have something else that I think is important to put in your life. It's great to learn from somebody who is godly. You know, stay close to somebody who has a desire for God. You'll begin to grow. When I was a teenager starting to serve Christ, I remember my pastor. The Lord had definitely put me on my pastor's heart. Basically, everywhere he went, he would take me with him. Everywhere he went, he would grab me and take me. If he was heading out of state, he'd go to my mom, "I would like to take him with me. Can I take him with me?" And he would take me with him. I'd head off with him. He was from West Virginia, so we'd drive to West Virginia and things like that. Well, it was during those times that I would begin to grow. And I would see different things about him. And I'm so thankful back for that time that the Lord had put me on his heart. We had his son, of course, him and his son and I became good friends up until about my senior year. He started headed in another direction. I remember even at that time, his dad, who was the pastor, never stopped. I would go. His son really didn't want to. He'd leave his son home. He'd take me. Let's go. You're going with me. It was an important time in my life. When I got to New Mexico, I had the example of Pastor Bird in my life. And getting to see things from a different perspective, I got to see what his strengths were and begin to learn from that. And then I was in Korea. There was two men I'd say God really used in Korea in my life. Bill Stewart, the missionary that was there, and Jim Taylor, the missionary who's now is currently there now at that work. And how God used their example in my life. And again, it wasn't just the teaching and preaching from the pulpit. That certainly was important. It was also the time that was spent there. I remember when I arrived in Korea, I was already being challenged. I was already going through the battle of my mind about the soul winning that had taken place in New Mexico and trying to figure this thing out. And Jim Taylor was one of the fellows who really was getting me into the Bible. He was challenging me in some of my different views of theology. And I realized, man, I have got to get much more into that Bible. And so God will put the people around you that you need. Then I come to Alaska, and of course I had Pastor Stan Roach that was here. And the godly example that he had provided. And then the day came when the Lord sent me. It was no more about being a disciple. He said, all right, we're changing things up. A transition is going to take place. You're heading to New Guinea. Although, looking back now, I see a great deal of time of New Guinea being much, much about still learning and schooling. But you need to learn from Christ. These were men who were with him. They spent time with him. They were genuinely converted to Christ, and they spent time with him. And then lastly, what we see about them is they were committed to Christ. This was something that they did have. They had a level of commitment to Christ. These men were ones who removed their own earthly ambitions and focused on Christ. They removed their earthly ambitions and they focused on Christ. They were ready to follow. Again, these men were not homeless men. These were men who had businesses and some of them very good work, such as Andrew and Peter, Matthew. But yet, when they realized who Christ was, when they saw him as that pearl of great price, they realized this is in fact the Messiah. They were willing to forsake all and follow Christ. They had a level of commitment about him. See, what God needs is, again, we've heard it said, it's not your ability that God's looking at, because many times it's your ability that can hinder you from serving God. It's just that humbleness before him and recognizing who he is and the desire to be with him. The desire to say, listen, this is what I want. And you have that commitment before the Lord. And setting aside our own earthly ambitions, they say, Lord, whatever you want. Whatever you want. That's who the Lord begins to use. That's when he's going to take you through a time in your life of schooling, of learning. But the day is going to come when the transition takes place. And he begins to send you. But we need to see ourselves as the ambassadors that we are before the Lord. And again, these men end up changing the world. Who would have thought they would have ever have amounted to too much? I would imagine, especially those first two and a half years, the Pharisees weren't too worried about these 12 men. Like, really? Matthew? Come on. Simon? And Peter? Nathaniel? Really? This is who he's selecting? This is who he's going to select? I don't think they're too worried about him. I think they looked at it from such a fleshly standpoint. They thought, these guys, you got to be kidding me. Them? Yep. Those men are going to end up changing the world. All of those men will end up giving their life for Christ. Because, one, they were genuinely converted. They learned from him. They spent time in school. Thirdly, they were committed. They were committed. With those things in place, what the Lord did, even though they struggled with so many different areas in their life, the Lord changed them and conformed them to the image of his dear son. That's how that takes place. With heads